Hello friends, yeah. My name is Sid Shah and I am from Think and Grow Rich Academy. Welcome all of you to this help talk. We are going to structure this session in a different way, but before that I'll introduce myself. I am a business coach and a life coach, and we have got the exclusive license from the Napoleon Hill Foundation, the author of Think and Grow Rich from the USA, to coach and train the principles of success as mentioned in the all-time best-selling book Think and Grow Rich. And so we have got this license from the US and we conduct workshops and seminars. I am a chartered accountant by profession. I did my MBA gold medalist from MIMS, been an entrepreneur for the last 17 years, and also I'm coming out with a book very soon titled Think, Believe and Achieve, which is having all the latest examples, up-to-date examples, that people who have followed these principles of success in their life, either knowingly or unknowingly. Yeah, so this is my brief introduction. I know I'm not being modest, but this is a brief introduction about myself. So the way we are going to structure our talk is that we are going to cover three core things. We are going to talk of something called DMP, which is the first principle of success, called definite major purpose. It is can be called the why of your life. So this is what we're going to talk of. We are also going to talk of the nine motives and why they are important for you to understand the nine motives. And lastly, we are going to discuss the 12 riches of life. Okay, so briefly we are going to cover this in whatever time we have got. All right, so friends, if I may ask you this question, have you heard about this book Think and Grow Rich, or read, anyone, if you have read the book Think and Grow Rich? Yeah, or at least heard. Yeah, wonderful. Yeah, so Think and Grow Rich is the number one best-selling book in the non-fiction category since last 80 years. It is still the number one best-selling book. This book has sold more than 125 million copies worldwide, and it has been translated into 35 different languages. And this is so, it is like said that it is not just a book. For me, I call it as a millionaire making factory. Now, why do they call that? Because it is a proven fact that this book has made more millionaires than any other success formula in the world. It's a proven fact, friends. So this is, there is something special about this book, and we're going to talk about that in detail. Now friends, if I may ask you, that would you be interested in a shortcut, that in one sentence you will get this entire book, the entire philosophy of Napoleon Hill? Would you be interested in that one sentence?
Definitely.
Of course, yes. So friends, this is the core theme of Think and Grow Rich. It's whatever the mind can conceive and believe, the mind can achieve. So you must have heard about this statement, probably read many a times in many books and all. It's a very simple statement, friends, but it takes a lifetime to execute. So I will help you to break this statement into three parts. Three parts mein hum isko divide karenge, so that you will be able to understand this one statement perfectly. What is the first part? Whatever the mind can conceive. So the conception happens from the mind. So now the thing is, the mind is not just in your brain, it is in every cell of your body. So the conception, the ideation happens from the mind. Alright? And the belief comes from the heart. So that's a combination of your mind and your heart together. These are the first two parts. And what is the last part, friends? The mind can achieve. Friends, it is not achieve, it is act achieve. This is where the difference is, that many people read this book and say, this book has done nothing for me. I mean, this book is not useful, friends. Because that is the crucial part where they don't take any action, where they are supposed to take action. So combination of your conception and your belief and unrelentless action towards your goal is the key to whatever you want to achieve, you can achieve, friends. So friend, this is the core theme of Think and Grow Rich. With that, we start with the first principle of success which you are going to cover today, which is definite major purpose. And I will give you two examples that will clarify that what should be a definite major purpose. I will give you one corporate example and I will give you a non-corporate example. So let's look at the first example. Before that, when you look at this slide, what do you look at the slide, and what in the context of definite major purpose, what do you see in this slide, friends? Yes?
compass.
It's a compass, correct? Yes. What else do you see?
There is a lighthouse.
Lighthouse, perfect. Yeah.
And there is a
small boat. A ship or a boat? Yes. Yes.
And
yes, and the sea. Yes.
Basically, it's like some direction. Where
direction. Yes. Yes. Wonderful. So every one of you is right, friends. And if I may ask you this question, that who are you? Who are you in this slide? Who are you in this slide?
The observer.
Observer? No.
I'm the boat.
You are the boat? But one step ahead, sir. You are the captain of the ship. Yeah, you're not just the boat or the ship, but you are the captain of the ship. So from that context, definite major purpose, let's jump into the first corporate example. Folklore of corporate. In May 1981, seven men meet in a tiny rented apartment in Mumbai. And they were together brainstorming that let's start a company. And they were thinking that what should be the definite major purpose of our company, all right? Someone said, let's target to have the largest sales or the revenue should be the top company. That should be the definite major purpose. Someone else said, no, let's give it back to the society and let's be the biggest job creators. Someone else said, no, let's rule the markets and let's have the highest market cap as our definite major purpose of our company. But someone else said, no, wait, we are into business and let's target profits as being the number one goal of our company. Somewhere the leader of the group came in and said, hold on guys, I've got a different perspective. Why don't we target to be the most respected company of India? Okay. So the others said that, what do you mean by respect and how do you get respect from the company's point of view? Friends, we all agree that we all want respect in our lives. Yeah. And this respect can be very different from each and every person. Yeah. So from the company's point of view, just look at the clarity of the person. Maybe you have guessed the example, but just look at the clarity of this person when he said that respect from the company's perspective, how can I get respect? Respect from the customers, you deliver what you promise and you will get respect. Respect from the employees, you treat them fairly and with dignity. Respect from the investors, you operate with transparency and accountability. Respect from the vendors, you deal with them on merits. Respect from the government, never violate any laws, especially when GST is in. Never respect from the society, create goodwill and live in harmony. So from all these associates, if you do this, you'll get respect, right? And then what will happen? The company would attract customers, employees, vendors, investors, and the result, revenues, profit, market cap, size, all will follow automatically. So friends, why don't we aim to be India's most respected company? Was the definite major purpose. Who was this gentleman who had this definite major purpose in May 1981 in a tiny rented apartment? He had this clarity of thought that this should be the definite major purpose of our company. Close back. Absolutely, yeah, of course. He is none other than Mr. Narayan Murthy from Infosys. And that definite major purpose has made all the difference, friends. All the difference that in a short span of time, what that particular company has achieved. So this is one example, friends, from a corporate point of view, that what can be a company's definite major purpose. But now let's say that I am not into business and I am not having a dream of building a corporate. Let's study a non-corporate example to give you better clarity that what a definite major purpose of an individual, what it can be. Okay, so I'll give you a non-corporate example. So when I was doing my training in US last year in Canada, I came back home after my training. So everything what I had studied was live in my mind. And then I went out for a movie with my family. And while watching the movie, I was like, oh my God, Sid, this person has followed everything what is mentioned in the book Think and Grow Rich to perfection. Whatever is mentioned, whatever I've learned, whatever I've been coached, he's following it everything. I'm sure you must have also heard or seen this movie. This movie was Dangal. Heard about this movie? Yeah? Yeah, of course, right? So friends, if I may ask you, what was Mahavir Singh Fogart's definite major purpose? What was its definite major purpose?
His daughter's champions.
To make his daughter's champions. But to be very specific, to win the gold medal for India in wrestling was his definite major purpose, to look into the proper context. And what happened, friends? I mean, he was himself a wrestler. He reached to the national levels, but then some circumstances happened. He couldn't go beyond the nationals. He didn't change his definite major purpose. He said, no, fine, if I have not done it, my son will do it. But as a chartered accountant, I could correlate. First attempt, second attempt, third attempt, nothing happened, right? And then what happened? Did he change his purpose? He said, no. If I can't do it, my son will do it. If I don't have a son, my daughters will do it. So he never changed his definite major purpose. And whatever criticisms and hurdles and obstacles which they had to face, he overcome each and every one. And finally, he achieved his definite major purpose. So friends, there are numerous other examples also, but this was one of the latest which has actually stuck in my mind as I came back from the US and immediately I saw the movie, so I could correlate with that. So friends, with these two examples, are you clear that what can be the definite major purpose of yourself if you want to think about yourself? Is the clarity coming with these two examples? One corporate and one non-corporate example. If this is clear, then we can proceed ahead. Yeah? Sure? Wonderful. So friends, let me ask you a simple question. What makes your desire a burning desire? Yeah, we sometimes say, I have got a burning desire to do this. What is it that makes your desire a burning desire, friends? Yes? Any inputs? What is it that makes you get up early in the morning and to do that? To follow your naturopathy practice or to be there, to be into the business? What is it, friends? The fire in the belly. How does that fire in the belly comes? To go and teach, to educate. Why is it? What is the real reason behind it?
Willingness and determination.
Good. Yes. Any other inputs?
At any cost.
At any cost, I need to achieve that. Yeah. So by come what may, that strong, determined willpower.
Strong.
Very good. Very good. Yes. Any other inputs?
Sorry? Satisfaction to your goal.
Satisfaction. Wonderful. Yes. Any other inputs? What is it that makes your desire a burning desire?
See, I have a different take on
this. Yes.
It's something I can do. Let me do it now because I've been passing this way for the last time.
Oh, wonderful. So do it now. Do it now is your mantra. Right. So everyone has a different take, friends, that come what may, do it, to have the satisfaction of the goal, to be doing that, whatever be the reason behind it. But I will give you a framework of the 9 motives, friends, which will actually give you the clarity that why you are doing what you are doing. What is it that makes your determination strong? Or what is it that makes you act upon the moment? Or what is it that gives you the satisfaction? Yeah? So are we ready to understand the 9 motives? These are the 9 motives written in the 100-year-old book, The Law of Success by Napoleon Hill. Yeah? And this 9 motives are so powerful that the entire 7 billion population on planet Earth are taking action by any of these 9 motives. Yeah? So let's go through the 9 motives. Yeah? The first motive, the desire for self-preservation and basic needs. What do you mean by this? Basic needs? Roti, kapda aur makan?
Survival.
Yeah? Survival. So if this is not there, agar ye nahi hai, to aadmi iske liye kuch bhi karega. This is the strongest motive for a person to do, agar roti, kapda, makan nahi hai to. Clear? The second motive, the emotion of love. Yeah? Very, very strong and powerful motive. So love means not just love for your soulmate, but love has a wider meaning. So let's say a mother's love for the child, she would do anything because of the love. Or let's also say the army officer's love for the country. I mean, he will die for the country. So love has a wider meaning, but it's a very, very strong motive to act upon. Yeah? The third motive, the emotion of fear, dar. Although negative, but it's a very, very powerful motive. Agar bank mein paisa nahi hai, to business band ho jayega. Agar job mein performance nahi kiya, to boss will sack me. If I don't score enough marks, I will fail. So this is also a very strong motive for a person to act upon. Yes? The fourth motive, the desire for life after death. Now this motive is actually related to many of our religions, where it is mentioned that if you do good deeds in this birth, in this life, you will have a better birth in your next life. And many people are driven to take action based upon this motive. Do good karma so you will have a better birth next time. So that is coming from this particular fourth motive. The fifth motive, the desire for freedom of body and mind. Yeah. So if a person is stuck up in a 9-to-5 job and he feels I don't want to work, I'm just over here for money. Once there is enough money in the bank, the next day I'm going to quit. I'm going to, you know, throw that paper on my boss's face. Why is that coming from? I want to travel the whole world. I want to be a free bird. Well, that is coming from this particular motive. Self-expression of body and mind. Clear? The sixth and the seventh motives are two negative motives which I have clubbed them together. The desire for revenge and the emotion of hatred. Very, very strong motives. Although negative motives, but very strong motives to take action. We take any Bollywood movie or a Hollywood movie, revenge movie. The hero will do anything to get to his particular thing. To a certain extent, even Ramayana and Mahabharata are based on these two motives. The trigger points were these two motives. Desire for revenge and the emotion of hatred. Yeah. And last, sorry, the eighth one, the desire for self-expression and recognition. The eighth motive. Name and fame. Actors, politicians, bureaucrats, TV stars. For their name and fame, they would go to any extent to do a particular action. Very, very powerful motive. That's the eighth one. And the last motive, money or material gain, most easily understood. So I have kept it the last. Not least important, but both easily understood, so I have kept it last. So friends, this nine motive framework is what is it that making your desire a burning desire. It is not necessary that all the nine motives should be there, friends. But maybe two or three strong motives are driving you to go to do whatever you are going to do, to achieve whatever you want to achieve. And why you need to understand the nine motives? Not to increase our general knowledge, friends, but there are two strong reasons why you need to understand these nine motives. So let's jump to the first reason that why you need to understand the nine motives. The first reason, when you understand the nine motives, you'll convert your ordinary desire into a burning desire. How? When you have strong connects of the motives to your goals, that why I am doing what I am doing. Is it because of money? Is it because of recognition? Is it because of freedom of body and mind? What is, I love that particular job. When you have strong connects with your motives, the better the chances of you to achieving that particular goal. Whatever the mind can conceive and believe, the mind can achieve. So you need to be very clear that why I am doing what am I doing by linking these motives with whatever you have outlined, that this is my goal or objective which I want to achieve. That is the first reason why we need to understand the motives, right? What is the second reason, friends? When you understand the motives, you will master the art of marketing. So what do I understand by this? Well, marketing should not be constrained as a very narrow concept. Friends, say, so let's say I'm from a finance background or I'm into HR, I'm not into marketing. No. So every person on planet Earth is a marketeer all the time. So when a child is crying, he's hungry, he's crying, he's marketing himself. Yeah, he's crying loudly, he's marketing himself more loudly. So have a wider perspective on what marketing is all about. And now how will you use the nine motives framework, friends? I will give you a master key. When you want your buyer to take a particular action to buy your product, what you need to do, you need to plant a motive in your buyer's mind. You need to plant a motive in your buyer's mind. And once your motive is planted, your job is done. You don't need to sell anymore. He will automatically buy from you. Yeah. So I will give an example. How does it work? Let's say insurance is something which you all need to be selling. Nobody buys insurance. We need to sell insurance, right? And primarily, most common motive used in insurance is, which motive is used? Fear?
Security.
Fear. So security comes from the motive of fear, right? So imagine when a salesman or an insurance agent walks in and when he plants that motive in that prospect's mind, socho, aapke baad kya hoga? That fear motive is planted, and how easy the insurance agent's job is, okay, leke ja, abhi ka bhi leke ja. Right? Yeah? So we plant the motive and your job is done. But friends, don't plant the same motive all the time. That's the key to become the master of marketing. For example, See, if I am a high net worth individual and I have secured enough for my family after me, right? So when someone plans the trying to plant a motive of fear, ki socho kya hoga, I would say fine, I am done with, you know, I don't want any further insurance with that motive. So that might not work. But maybe some other motive, maybe money or recognition or some other motive being planted will definitely help me to take that action. So friends, which motive to be planted when is something which you will come to know by experience. The more you use these motives in your daily routine, it could be in your family also. If you want some action to be taken from any of your family members, try it out. Plant a motive and your job is done. Plant a motive and your job is done. So friends, two important reasons. First, to make your desire into a burning desire, and second, to master the art of marketing. This is the reason why we need to understand the 9 motives framework. Yeah, good enough? Fine. Now to summarize the first principle of definite major purpose, friends, we are going to discover our definite major purpose over here. So I am going to give you some helpful tips that what is it that makes a definite major purpose. So definite major purpose is the why of your life. It is the reason of your existence. It is the context of your life. And it is the starting point of all achievement. All the ideation, everything happens with a particular goal or an objective in your mind. So that is the starting point of achievement. But friends, the irony is that 98% of the population on planet Earth are not able to discover their definite major purpose of life. That's the irony, friends, and that is the reason why there are only 2% people in that success bracket who are blessed enough to have discovered their definite major purpose. So this is the irony, friends, that people know that we need to understand our definite major purpose, but we are not able to discover that. And I am going to take a promise from all of you over here that I want you to be into that 2% bracket who are able to discover your definite major purpose. Alright? So that is some helpful more tips. Have a goal with a time deadline. Don't have a goal without a time deadline, otherwise it will just remain a wish. Any goal without a time deadline will never work. It will just remain a simple wish. What next? Capitalize on your experience and your background. So if you are planning to achieve a particular goal, maybe your educational background, your experiences would be definitely be an added advantage for you to help you to achieve that goal. So it's always easier to achieve a particular goal which is linked up with your experience and your background. Yeah. What other tips are there? Take action now. As my friend said, we have to believe in action. There is never going to be a perfect time to start action. We have to take action right now. Write down the statement of your definite major purpose, friends. Most important. You should not trust your memory. The pen and paper are the biggest and the best inventing tools which mankind has ever invented. Use them. Don't trust your memory. Write down your definite major purpose of your life or your goal. Break it into minor goals and plans so that we come to know that whether we are proceeding to the right track or not, we can get some feedback ourselves. And are we going in the right direction or not? Describe what you intend to give. Very, very important, friends. We all say, I want this, I want that, I want to achieve this, I want to achieve that. But friends, this is where most of the people fail. They are not very clear that how am I going to add value? What am I giving first to my customers or my target audience? So first, be very clear what is your intention, what you intend to give first. Be very clear about it. When this is very clear, the universe will automatically pay back. So first, describe what you intend to give. Don't just focus on getting. Describe what you intend to give. Sign your statement. What is the reason of signing? That you are giving your word, your integrity, that you are committed to this particular thing. So you need to sign your statement, which we are going to do this exercise over here, where there is a space over here where we all are going to sign yourself on this particular goal in our life. And read it aloud with emotions and visualizations. The best way to bombard your subconscious mind, to tap your subconscious mind, is to bombard it with reading it aloud with emotions and visualizations. So they'll figure it out, the ways to reach where you want to reach, friends. So these are some of the helpful tips for you to actually outline your definite major purpose of your life. Yeah, the first principle of success is definite major purpose. We're going to talk on all the other principles on different talk shows, but this is the starting point of all achievement where everything is started. Everything is started with this definite major purpose. Even what we are talking right now, where people talk of discovering the why of your life or begin with an end in mind. There are various new philosophies which have come up, new age philosophies. But it all boils down to this one particular thing which Napoleon Hill discovered 100 years ago when he was researching, that this is your definite major purpose. Discover your definite major purpose of your life. Yeah. So now, friends, I'll give you some prominent examples which will again clarify that how these people have achieved with their definite major purpose. The first one, the first Prime Minister of Singapore, he had this definite major purpose of achieving Singapore as a developed country even after the devastation of the Second World War. Yeah. Conrad Hilton, the founder of Hilton Hotels, one of the most widely recognized hotel chains in the world. And the last example, friends, was was a success story when I was doing my research in Canada and US. And this is the best example of having a person with a definite major purpose, friends. And this is from India, our very own Mahatma Gandhi. He had this definite major purpose and he achieved that. He has also been a case study where we actually depicted the movie Gandhi and were correlating what all things which he has followed, which are mentioned in Think and Grow Rich, and they were all matching to perfection. Small incidences of Gandhi movie, he correlated with that, and they were actually what Napoleon Hill had written in his book, completely matching what Gandhi had followed in achieving his definite major purpose. Yeah. So friends, this is the exercise which we are going to do right now. I would want that you can start with this, the first exercise which is there, where you are going to write down your major goal in life. If you are not very clear about your goal in life, but maybe you can start off, say, I want to achieve by December 2017 this particular thing, or I want to achieve by March 2018, I want to achieve this. Start with that framework. Write down three simple action steps, the key action steps which you are going to take to achieve that particular goal or an objective. The date, by what date you want to achieve it, most importantly. You need to sign it and write today's date also in that, so you are committed to it. And on this date, I am committing to myself to take all these actions to achieve this definite major goal of my life. Yeah. So I will give you a couple of minutes. I am there to help you around. Of course, it requires a lot much more of our time, but given the context of what we are sitting right now, a couple of minutes of you and we can go to the next slide, please. Yeah. With this, we have got this second page where the nine basic motive framework is there. On the next page, we have got the nine basic motive framework. Now, in this, what we are going to do, whatever you have written as your major goal in your life on the first page, you are going to link that major goal with the nine motive framework. That what is it that it is inspiring you to take action on a scale of 1 to 10, where 1 being the least ranked in inspiring action and 10 being the highest ranked in inspiring action. So I will give you some examples, tips how to use this thing. You need not rank all the nine motives. For example, if you don't have hatred as a motive or greed as a motive, you can rank a 0 to them. Absolutely fine. You need not rank all the nine motives. And you can have the same ranking for more than one motive also. For example, there are two strong motives which I have got. You can rank 10 as these are the two strong motives which I have got. Clear on the instructions? Yeah. So do the first page of writing the definite major purpose and also the motives linked to that. Please start. You need a sheet, right? Yeah. Yeah, if you got. Yeah. Give me a picture. DMP stands for definite major purpose. The why of your life is the reason of your being, the context of your being is the reason of your existence, and we are going to link these nine motives to discover your definite major purpose. That how are these nine motives inspiring you to take some action to determine your particular goal in your life or whatever you want to achieve. And the key over here is that the stronger the connects which you have with the nine motives, the better the chances of yours to achieve your definite major purpose. Hurdles, obstacles are quite common for every human being. It's a part and parcel. Whenever you are down and out, friends, if you are very clear that these are the motives which are inspiring me to take action to achieve this goal, you'll be able to overcome your hurdles and obstacles in a much more better way as compared to without having clarity that why you are doing what you are doing. This is the reason of connecting your 9 motives to your definite major purpose. Fine. Now, can I ask you this simple question, friends? Is money the only richness in your life? Yeah? There are other riches, right?
So many other riches,
yeah. So if I may hear from you, friends, which other richness is important?
I would say at my age is health.
Absolutely. Very second, nice. Second, at every age it is health,
second
for
would
sure.
Be the consciousness of my action.
Consciousness, very wonderful, wonderful thought. Yes.
And third would be going through what life I have gone to create an asset for the needy.
Asset for the needy. Wonderful thought, Maharaji. Yes.
I read that stage.
Yeah, yes. Any other inputs? What are the different richnesses in life?
Family,
wonderful. Yes, it's a very important richness. Yeah. So, I'm going to give you a framework which Napoleon Hill discovered of the 12 riches of life. Of course, money is one of them. Money is most commonly understood. Think and grow rich. The first thought which comes into our mind is the money in the bank. But friends, the idea to give you this perspective of the 12 riches is very simple, friends. Whatever level of richness you had when you entered the room before the talk show started, after the talk show, you should feel much more richer about yourself. That no, I've got this richness which maybe I'm taking it for granted. That is the real objective of understanding the other 11 riches of life. Yeah. So let's look at the other 11 riches of life and then let's connect that also with your definite major purpose. And beautifully, we'll connect all the 3 concepts together. We'll interweave all the 3 concepts. Yeah. So I'll start with the 12 riches of life. The first richness, which is most important, which Napoleon Hill talks of, is positive mental attitude. Whatever be the situation, friends, this is the first richness which you should have if you want to achieve anything. I mean, if you have this as an attitude, you are saying you got this, right? So this is the first richness which you should have, which is positive mental attitude. Second richness, sound health. Yeah, we all agree with that. Health is wealth. Very important context. And we are over here in this context, it is the most important richness in our life. The third, harmony in human relations. As someone said, family. So what's the point in having all the money when you are just all alone by yourself? You need someone to share your loved ones, your near and dear ones. So that's a very important richness in your life. The fourth, freedom from fear. Freedom from all kinds of fear. I mean, there are 6 basic fears which we talk of, which Napoleon Hill talks of. 6 basic fears, and of course there are many other fears also. But every person on planet Earth faces these 6 basic fears. There's fears of death, fear of losing money, fear of old age, fear of criticism, and fear of loss of love. So these are the 6 basic fears.
And the fear of insecurity.
Insecurity, yes. The fear of losing money is, yeah.
The highest fear.
Yes. Yes. So these are the 6 basic fears. And freedom from all these kind of fears, don't you think so it's a richness in our life? Yeah. It's a very important richness. Yeah. The fifth richness, the hope of future achievement. You have mentioned some goal or target to be achieved by this particular date. That is what is making you get up early in the morning and going to go wherever you're going to go and achieve that thing. That's the driving force. And that's the richness which you have got. You have something to look forward to, the hope of future achievement. That's a richness in your life. The sixth is the capacity of applied faith. Now, applied faith is again a principle of success in itself. I'll define for you what is applied faith. Applied faith is the unwavering belief in yourself and your abilities to achieve your definite major purpose or goal in your life. I repeat, applied faith is the unwavering belief in yourself and your abilities to achieve your definite major purpose in your life. So it's something that we call self-confidence, or you call that belief system or that intuition that, no, I'm going to do that, what I'm going to do that. So that is also a richness. What's the point being a doubter of your own capabilities whenever you're going out in the world to achieve what you want to achieve in your life? And that's richness which you should have, right? The seventh one, willingness to share one's blessings with others. That's a true richness. So friends, when we look at the Forbes richest list, we look at the richest person in the world, and we all know Bill Gates is the richest person in the world. But friends, also look at the other list, the biggest givers in the world. And you will see that the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation, yes sir, is the biggest charitable trust in the world. Somewhere, Bill Gates knows what true richness is all about. We just don't look at one list of the richest people, also look at the other list who are the biggest givers in the world, and that richness comes from this willingness to share one's blessings with others. You need not be Bill Gates to share your blessings, friends. Just a simple note of thanks is also sharing which you can do, friends. Or a thought of gratitude, even that is something which is a richness in your life. Right?
You can always count on your blessings.
Absolutely. So that's a richness in our life. Yeah.
Yes, sir.
Azim Premji, of course, how can we forget that?
India.
One of the richest people in India. And he's such a biggest, what he has done for primary education for children is remarkable with the Azim Premji Foundation. And he's such a simple person. I really admire Azim Premji. Yes. So these people know what is true richness in their life. Yeah. The eighth one, loving your profession or your job. Don't you think that's a true richness in your life? What's the point in just being there for money when you are not able to do, you're in such a noble thing which you are doing, and that's a richness in your life, having to do what you are loving to do. That's a richness. An open mind on all subjects. Friends, we are all over here gathered together because we have an open mind. What's the point in having a closed mind? If you would have closed mind, friends, you would have used the rotary phones till date. But we all have smartphones now because we have an open mind, and that's a richness in our life. Complete self-discipline. Again, that's a very important richness. So as youngsters, we can say that, you know, when you get up early in the morning, you feel so bad about yourself when there are three snoozes of 10 minutes, and then, oh my God, where this half an hour went away, I really wasted my half an hour early in the morning. And how good you feel about yourself when on one, without a snooze, on one stroke, you're able to get up. That's self-discipline, and that's a richness which you should have in your life. Complete self-discipline. The 11th, the capacity to understand people, to be on the same wavelength. People say that if you are able to understand people, your productivity would be multiplied. Your effectiveness would be multiplied. That is a richness in your life. The major problem is there are no problems if you are able to understand. There are no problems. Yeah, and that's a richness in your life. And last but not the least, it doesn't require any explanation, money or economic security or wealth or whatever you call it. So this is not the least important, but Napoleon Hill ranks it the 12th because it is the most easily understood. So from the context of Napoleon Hill, there are these 12 riches of life which every person should be aware of so that you will feel much richer about yourself. And when you feel richer about yourself, the money in the bank will automatically come. Yes, the money in the bank will automatically come because like attracts like. If you feel richer, money will automatically come. So I am going to connect with this 12 riches to a definite major purpose. So when you are writing this 12 riches with this definite major purpose, the exercise which we are going to do is, again, on the scale of 1 to 10, you are going to rank the riches of your life, 1 being the least important and 10 being the most important. So when a youngster is just running after money, maybe he would have economic security as 10. And he would say, sound health, I don't care. I want 0 or 1 or 2. I don't have any problem. But he doesn't realize that this is going to catch up to him sooner or later. So this perspective given at the right time will help him to have a balanced and a holistic perspective to define his definite major purpose. I just want money. I don't care about my family. I don't have time for my family. How about the third richness of harmony in human relations? You're going to affect that richness, right? So having a balanced approach in defining your definite major purpose, and by linking these 12 riches, again, is going to give you much more clarity that why you are doing what you are doing. Whether you are climbing the ladder on the right wall, lean on the right wall, or you want to win the rat race and still be called a rat. So that is something which will give you clarity when you are going to link these 12 riches with this definite major purpose. And friends, many a times we have goals, we have objectives written and we achieve them. It's not that we have not achieved them. But many a times it feels that the kind of happiness levels which I had expected that I would get after achieving that particular goal is not that much as I would have thought through. Theek hai, ho gaya, abhi kya? Have you experienced this feeling? It comes, right? Yeah. Why is that? The primary reason is that when we are defining this definite major purpose, we are not very clear that how it is going to be impacting our 12 riches of life. Now, with this clarity of the 12 riches of life, when you are defining your definite major purpose, be very clear that by doing this, how is it going to impact my 12 riches of life? What is the impact on my health? What is the impact on my relationships? What is the impact on my discipline? And then when you achieve that, believe me friends, the level of satisfaction which you will get now with this awareness will be far, far more. It will be multiplied. And that satisfaction level is something to be experienced when you are able to clarify this between all the three things completely. And what I call this framework of Napoleon Hill is the crux of entire Napoleon Hill philosophy from which the entire self-development industry has begun. I mean, this was a seed from which Napoleon Hill researched for 20 long years. And from this particular core, the three pillars which I call definite major purpose, the 9 motives and the 12 riches is something every one of you should be very, very clearly understood so that you can have a more happily fulfilled and we can all start to truly think and grow rich from the right perspective. Friends, my name is Sid Shah and my contact number is 98200-23589. So if you want to know more about our academy, you can always WhatsApp me on this number or you can go on and visit my blog, my personal website, sidshah.co.in. And our mission of the academy is to coach and train every possible Indian with the world's best and the world's first philosophy of personal achievement as coined by Napoleon Hill, from where every new age guru has taken and borrowed and given testimonials for Napoleon Hill and Think and Grow Rich, friends. So it has been a real pleasure and honor for me to be with this wonderful audience, friends. So let's hear it for all of us, friends. Thank you so much.